Everybody, it's a nice January morning. It's very chill and very nice to face such a morning in Trichy. Is really it's not very common. A word about today's host, a PhD in agricultural geography. I really didn't know there was agricultural geography till I heard about it from Lata, an academician. This lady is a faculty in the Department of Earth Sciences in Bharatidasan University, Trichy. She's a content creator in geography and has published many, many research articles. She is interested in creating new approaches in learning, and recently she has been involved in studying the relation between online and offline learning environments. We all know her as a very creative person who loves to merge a bit of fun, education, self-development, and personal growth in her life and make it most productive. It's my pleasure to introduce a member of our forum, the Aura, Dr. Lata Pala, for you, the anchor for this morning's meeting. Over to Lata Pala. Lata, shall I?
Thank you, Mrs. Vrinda, for this, such a nice introduction. I've unmuted myself. Hope you all hear me. A very good morning to all of you gathered here. This is a much awaited day for every member of our club, I know. Heartfelt welcome to Dr. Margaret Parenchpe, Indian novelist, poet, literacy critic, who has joined us from Shimla. He will educate us with his experiences on practical Vedanta, spirituality in daily life. I take immense pleasure in welcoming Madam Mrs. Sunantha Raj from Tokyo and Ms. Gayatri Iyer, who have joined with him too. I would also like to introduce me lastly. May I summon all and sundry to invoke the Almighty through an universal prayer song. This song was given by Mahathir, the spiritual leader, in his infantism. May I request Mrs. Vrinda to share the screen with the lyrics. And here it goes. Feeling like presence, feeling thy grace, feeling thy radiance. You are my source of faith and strength. You are my path and destination. I am always connected to you. Nothing of me, everything of you. Lead me higher, lead me deeper, lead me beyond, lead me to you. Thank you, Vrinda. Friends, recently I was allotted an assignment to create a content for the newly launched subject. The title of the subject is Religion and Spiritual Wellness Geography. It is all about how geographical locations have influenced the religion and spirituality, including the map making too. The research and the materials preparation are halfway through, but yet I want to share my understanding about religion and the relationship between the spirituality, the religion, and wellness in a group discussion in my classroom. A student asked me, "Madam, do evil exists like darkness and cold. While I was thinking to give a voice back to him, and the other student replied, "Darkness doesn't exist because it is only the absence of light," he said. "Cold doesn't exist because it is the absence of heat." And similarly, evil is the result of absence of godly love in a human heart. Hearing this, I was speechless and tongue-tied. Spirituality is a core element that everyone strives to attain in his lifespan to give a true meaning of his existence in this materialistic world. I feel that spirituality is not a theory, not an abstract idea, but it is something that should be experienced, as it is an ongoing and coherent approach to life that should be consciously pursued, right? Then, what is the relationship between spirituality and religion? God dwelt in all heart, says Bhagavad Gita. One God is hidden in all things, by Upanishad. The kingdom of God is within you, says Jesus. Discovering high values in ourselves is the spirit, says Buddhism. There are some who describe themselves as spiritual without adhering to any religion. For many, practicing dance, yoga, meditation, and even volunteering work are the outlets to express their spirituality, right? Fine. Is spirituality and health connected to each other? I recognize that. Just as physical wellness describes the body, the spiritual wellness describes the health and spirit. I think people in good spiritual health may be optimistic, hopeful, compassion, empathy, and has a strong sense of self-worth. Dear friends, to conclude with, I acknowledge that spirituality is an umbrella term that contains in it several other notions in life. To perceive to a greater extent, at this juncture, I'm profusely overjoyed and privileged to take this moment to introduce our chief esteemed guest speaker, Dr. Maharan Paranjpe. Our guest needs no introduction. However, in this delightful occasion, I would like to highlight some aspects of his credentials through a short visual. May I request Mrs. Virinda to share the screen, please?
Brinda, the audio is missing. Brinda, would you want to play it again with the audio because the audio is missing? Sorry, Brinda, the video is missing now. Brinda? Brinda, the video is missing. Thank you.
Vrinda, I think you have to share screen. You haven't.
Let me know if you can see it or not, okay?
Yes. Thank you, Mrs. Vrinda. Thanks for helping me in sharing the video.
Sorry, Lata. Sorry, I made a mistake.
Thank you so much. Thanks for sharing the video, Mrs. Vrinda. Friends, are we not excited to note the amazing contribution of our guest? Yes, right. Our guest's understanding on Vivekananda and Gandhiji has left a great domain of three heads: head, heart, and hand. He believes in this paradox: the most you know about spiritualism, the less you know about it. You know, he adds, spirituality is for masses, but not for classes alone. Dear friends, now it is time to cleanse ourselves. And only I request you all, ladies, please welcome Dr. Maharand Paranjpe. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
We could hear you very well, sir.
Okay. First of all, I'm quite overwhelmed by that wonderful slide presentation that you made. Thank you for that. Thank you for taking the trouble. Thank you, Sunandaji and other friends. So first of all, I want to say that our talk today is on practical spirituality, rather practical Vedanta spirituality in daily life. Now, in India, we believe that if you want to learn about practical spirituality, you have to learn it from your mother, from the ladies of the house, because more than any other part of the world, you know, we believe that Bharat Shakti is women's Shakti in India. And that is why we say Bharat Mata, Bhavani Bharati. So it is the women of India who have kept the flame of spirituality alive in the heart, in the home, and in society. And when I think about the Aura Ladies Forum, yesterday I saw some parts of your website. I was very impressed. There seem to be six dynamic ladies who run the Aura Ladies Forum. And if six ladies can get along and do things together in the spirit of public service, we can change the world. So rather than my telling you about practical spirituality, I think I should learn from you. Because if any one of you has succeeded in, you know, ensuring that you have a happy home, a happy spouse, and happy children, I think you have mastered the art of living, and we have to learn from you and sit at your feet what practical spirituality is. I can only add a coda or a caveat that if you do this without anxiety, then that is the test. But if you're anxious that your happiness will be snatched away from you, then you're more like us, ordinary mortals. But if you can do it with a calm and you know, heart filled with confidence, acquired confidence and faith, then you have mastered the art of practical spirituality. So I will give you a couple of examples, you know, of what I mean by practical spirituality. Of course, the title of the talk comes from Swami Vivekananda, right? He gave three talks in London. I think they were on the 10th, 12th, and 17th of November in 1896, when he was visiting the US. Then he also crossed over to the continent and to England, and he gave these three talks. They're widely available on the internet. You can easily download them and read them. And I will talk a little bit about them. In fact, he says in his very first talk, and maybe you've taken a quotation from this talk already, but I will repeat it. He says, "All the powers in the universe are already yours. It is we who have put our hands before our eyes and cry that it is dark. Know that there is no darkness around us. Take the hands away, and there is the light which was from the beginning." Then he also says, "Thus Vedanta not only insists that the ideal is practical, but that it has been so all this reality is our own nature." Then he also says in this talk, "The Vedanta recognizes no sin. It only recognizes error. And the greatest error," says Vedanta, "is to say that you're weak, that you're a sinner, a miserable creature, and that you have no power and you cannot do this or that. So we'll come back to these talks in a minute, but this is the essence of what Swamiji means by practical Vedanta. So the title is taken from him. But we should also consider what is impractical Vedanta, right? If this is practical Vedanta, then what is impractical Vedanta? So I can say that impractical Vedanta implies two different things. On the one hand, it implies only theoretical knowledge and not practical knowledge. And on the other hand, it implies a really foolish kind of Vedanta. So we'll talk about both of that in a moment. But for me, you know, I gathered some theoretical knowledge about Vedanta or about spirituality from books. But practical Vedanta I saw in action. I learned from the great masters, you know, my own master, Yogi Ram Sarath Kumar of Thiruvannamalai. Before that, I used to go to Ramana Ashram. And then somebody said, there's a living Siddha in the vicinity. You must go and see him. And so I got connected. And it was a wonderful experience for me because I didn't know anything about him. And the day I went to see him in the Sannidhi Street house near the big temple, the Arunachaleshwara temple in Thiruvannamalai, and he had a small house there, and I was going up the steps and Ilyaraja was coming down the steps. So I knew his music, but I had never seen him, you know. And there were all these street urchins that clambered onto the windows. So it was a very chaotic scene, you know. And in the dim room, I went inside and I saw, you know, this person with a turban and a beard. And he was actually smoking. So I said, wow, I mean, because we thought that these Mahatmas are not supposed to smoke and all that, you know. And then I found that there was no smell of the smoke in the house, in that room at all. And so I said, that's also strange because I'm very sensitive to tobacco smoke. I had no smoke smell and he was there. And then some interesting things happened. But the long and short is when my turn came, he just raised his hand and he says, my father blesses Makaran Paransky. First he says, what is your name? And then something happened. My mind became very quiet and so on and so forth. And then the second time, I mean, what I'm trying to say is that when I used to visit Yogi Ram Sarath Kumar, he never spoke about Vedanta. He never spoke about spirituality, you know. In fact, he used to ask me questions about what is the river? You went to such and such a country. You went to Germany. Oh, you went to Berlin. What is the river in Berlin? You know, these are the sorts of questions he would ask me. But the thing I wanted to say is the second time he actually invited me, Ma Devaki, who is in the ashram now. So she wrote me a letter and she says, this beggar says he wants to see you. He used to call himself Pichakara and all that, you know, this dirty beggar. He would always refer to himself like that. So I reached there at 4:30 in the morning to Thiruvannamalai. I had flown in from Delhi and then from the airport, I took a vehicle to Kalasipal. And I reached Thiruvannamalai at 4:30 in the morning. And that time they were in another house. It was actually the house of the mothers, you know, nearby. And not that Sannidhi Street house. But the long and short is, I didn't want to go there at 4:30 in the morning. So I went to Raman Ashram, I took a bath, and then I started going up the hill. And I met some people, I had some interesting incidents, but I couldn't come down till 4:30 in the evening. That's my point. And when I came down, I mean, it was a very difficult trip and I had no intention of going up. And apparently Yogi was waiting for me. And he came out many times and said, where is Makaran Paranjpe? Where is he? Etc. But the thing I wanted to say is when I came inside the house at about 4:30, I was allowed inside. I met Ma Devaki and she said, have you eaten? This is what she asked me. And I think this is practical spirituality because I had nothing in mind. I didn't know who Yogi Ram Sarath Kumar was, but obviously I was ravenous. So she said, have you eaten? And so for me, that was practical spirituality. So she said, well, most of the food is over. I have some bread, I have some sambar, and I have some simple vegetables. I said, okay. So after I ate that, then I could feel some energy in me. So what I'm trying to simply say is that theory we may learn from books, we may get some idea. But practical spirituality, we learn from gurus, from the great people who practice it. And even in Ramanashram, if you read about what happened in Ramanashram, he never explained anything. He hardly said anything. He didn't speak a word. And people came with all kinds of problems, but they found peace and solace. So similarly, I visited Yogi Ramsurat Kumar many times, and I hardly heard him speak about spirituality. But people would come and pour out their problems to him. Somebody would say, oh, my son, he's not studying. I'm afraid he'll fail in his exams. Someone else would say, there's a quarrel in the family. The business is going down. Someone else would say, my mother is ill. So throughout, I only heard human suffering being talked about. And the difference was that Yogi would say, my father blesses you, my father blesses so-and-so. He would take their name and bless them. For me, that was practical spirituality. Not what is the Atman, what is the Brahman, you know, what is the relationship between these things. You know, I'm not saying that's not important. And this I want to now link to the main topic today, which is Swami Vivekananda's idea of practical Vedanta, by talking about Thakur, his own guru, Sri Ramakrishna. And he used to give a wonderful example. So he used to say, what is spirituality? Then he says, you know, the maid servant, she comes into your house and, your child is crying. She'll pick up your child and she'll say, oh, you're my Rama, you're my Krishna. I'm quoting, I mean, in today's world, nobody says that, those days. And then she cleans the house. You know, she cleans the vessels, whatever. But all along, she knows this is not her house. This is not her child. She's come from somewhere else. So he says, this is practical spirituality. Basically, this reality is not your ultimate reality. If you bear this in mind, when you do all your tasks and duties with all your heart, then that is practical spirituality, you know. So Thakur's lessons were like that. And similarly, if we look at the life of Sharada Ma, the Holy Mother, it was full of such practical nostrums and lessons, not some abstruse and abstract philosophical, you might say, discourses and deep analysis. But, you know, having said that, you know, please, let's look at what Swamiji has to say, at least because we, you know, got the title of this talk from him. And the most important thing, by the way, there's a running theme through all these three talks. And the running theme is the story of stories from the Chandogya Upanishad. And the Chandogya Upanishad is an amazing Upanishad because for the first time we hear a convocation address in that, you know, these students have come and they've all graduated and the teacher is sending them away. And he's giving them instructions, you know. So Satyam, Vada, Dharmam, Chara, all these instructions come in there. It's a beautiful, beautiful Upanishad. And it shows the flexibility and freedom of mind in ancient India. Because the teacher says, you know, keep learning after you leave this academy. And if you find a greater teacher, follow him. Don't get stuck with me, you know. What a great message. What a great convocation address. And what a great knowledge society India was, you know, about 4,000 years ago. It's an early Upanishad, the Chandogya. Some people date it to 1800 before the current era. It's almost 2,000 years ago. But even if it's not that old, you know, for us, we don't live in chronological time in India, right? We live in metaphysical time. And the great Shankara said, he says, Swadesham Bhuvanatrayam, that all the three worlds are my home because my mother is Parvati and my father is Shiva. So I'm always at home anywhere in the cosmos, right? So anyhow, Swamiji's running theme in the three talks is the Chandogya Upanishad. and it deals with Shvetaketu, Aruni, and Uddalak, three generations of great spiritual sages and seers. But what is it that Swamiji is saying? He's saying that in ancient India, the kings taught spirituality, not the priests or the rishis. So actually the Upanishad talks about how after graduating, you know, the person hasn't learned the secret of the Atman and his father teaches him, and that's how you get the Mahavakya, Tattvamasi, you know. That Tattvamasi Mahavakyam comes in this Upanishad. But other than that, even the father has to learn the knowledge from Janak, the king. So what Swamiji is saying is in ancient times, Vedanta was always practical. It was not world-renouncing, and it was taught by kings and monarchs who taught sages, you know. So Vedanta was never impractical. Only later on, for a variety of reasons, we thought that reality is getting away from the world, let's say becoming a monk or going away somewhere. In ancient India, the kings learned from the sages and the sages learned from the kings. There was a symbiosis, you know. And the beauty was that even when the sages and the rishis, the way they lived, there was a Gurukul. Why was it called a Gurukul? Because they were householders. They were not monks, okay? And they raised their own children and they raised the children of others who were sent to them for education. So the Vedic ideal was not an ideal of renunciation, because that came later for a variety of reasons. And there were, of course, the Shramanas who used to wander about, Avadhutas. So there was always a large number of people in India who were seeking the divine outside of the confines of their homes or the courts. And they were ever free. They used to roam around, you know, and do what they liked in the pursuit of the divine. So such characters also come. But the stable and of sages and the symbiosis between them, that was the old way in which Bharatvarsha was. And I mentioned about the Shakti of our land, and it was always the women who upheld. And we abroad, we used to hear earlier on, before feminism and all, about the weaker sex and all that. But in India, we always knew that the women were the stronger sex. Why is that? They not only could give birth and nurture a child, and they carried the sources of nourishment in their own bodies, but they were biologically stronger. They live longer. This has been proven. Women have a life expectancy higher than men. They have higher resistance to disease. Even in corona, less women have died than men, you know. And so they are the stronger species, for the simple reason that nature has ordained that for the species survival, even if a few males survive, the species will carry on. But the women must, you know, survive. So it's nature's doing. And you see, in the south, one Kannagi could destroy Pumpuhar, you know. So one Sita could destroy Lanka. One Draupadi could destroy all of the Kauravas. So women are the stronger sex according to India, right? And in the end, I'm going to tell you the story of Madalasa from the Markandeya Purana. It's also a very old Purana. You may know it. I've sent Vrindaji, the lullaby that Madalasa sang to her children, okay? So I hope you can play it at the end. But now, so what is Swamiji saying? Swamiji starts with Chandogya Upanishad, then he comes to the Bhagavad Gita, and he says, Krishna's message to Arjuna was practical, that you have to live in this world, you have to fight your enemies, you have to fight the Kauravas. That is Vedanta, not throwing your bow and arrow and Sidanti Mama Gatrani, he says, you know, Arjun. And then he says, no, this is not the way. You know, your limbs are trembling, your throat is dry, you have, and this is the sign of a coward. Get up and fight, he says. You know, that is practical Vedanta. Get up and fight. Do not run away from the problems of life. Okay? So I already read a couple of quotations. And now in this first lecture given in London, can you imagine people had hardly heard about Vedanta? They didn't know about Chandogya Upanishad. And Swamiji is going there and creating a spiritual storm, okay? Then he says, after he talks about how Vedanta believes that you are the source of power, the power lies within you, and it is an error to regard yourself as a sinner or to regard yourself as weak. After that, he says the central idea of Vedanta is oneness, okay? But how do you recognize oneness? He says you recognize oneness through love. And I'll quote him. He says, love binds, love makes for that oneness. You become one, the mother with the child. Again, that example, families with the city, the whole world becomes one with the animals. These are words of Swami Vivekananda. For love is existence, God himself, and all this manifestation of that one love, more or less expressed. The difference is only in degree, but it is the manifestation of that one love throughout. And then he ends the speech by saying, never think there is anything impossible for the soul. It is the greatest heresy to think so. If there is a sin, this is the only sin, to say you're weak or others are weak. So the soul of Vedanta is oneness, and oneness is realized through love. And because the creation or the cosmos itself is an expression of love, you know, the creator out of love divided himself or herself, if we believe she was the divine mother, so that she could experience her own infinitude through individuality, through separation, you know, and that the source of all power is already within you. You know, all powers in the universe are already yours, says Swami Vivekananda, right? Then, let's go to part two very quickly, which was delivered, as I said, on the 12th of November, 1896, again in London. And Swamiji says, as our human relationships can thus be made divine, so our relationship with God can take on any form, and we can look upon him as our father or mother or friend or beloved. So the point is that God is invisible. We can't see God clearly, but we see around us our parents, so we can see in them some aspect of the divine. We can see our children around us. We can see some aspect of the divine in our children. And all of you who have had the wonderful joy and experience of being mothers, I'm sure that at some point or the other, you would have seen, like Yashoda herself in your own child, an embodiment of the cosmic divine, like she saw Krishna, in Krishna opened his mouth, baby Krishna. I think all mothers must have seen a glimpse of the divine in the artless beauty and smile of a little child. As a father, certainly I have, I can tell you. It's something beyond human comprehension. And then attachment and all of that, mine, those things come, obviously, but this is something deeper and beyond that. And similarly, the Gita shows the divine as a friend. Arjuna and Krishna are friends, after all. And so he says, when he sees the Vishwarupa, he says, no, I don't like this form. Come back to me as my friend, so as my sakha. And then, of course, in Radha and Krishna, you see Madhurya Bhava, which is considered the highest form of love and devotion. The Bhakti Rasa is the highest manifested in its highest form in Madhurya Bhakti. And it is also Parakya, because Radha is not the wife, so to speak, the legally wedded wife of Krishna, and yet their relationship transcends what we understand of carnality. Obviously, it's a love that is so beyond. And when you read the Bhagavatam, there's no Radha in the Bhagavatam, as you know. She comes later, you know, Jayadeva and others. And some people say Radha comes from the south. Nippani, I think. in Andal and all that, that is the shepherdess. So some people say that Radha migrates, you know, from the stories of the devotees of the south to the north. As they say, bhakti comes from the south, by the way. So that is more or less understood even among the Nayanars. You have great bhaktas like Kannappa, very, very great bhaktas. They offer their eye and all that. So you have this Ugra bhakti, you have Saumya bhakti, you have all kinds of bhakti in the south. You also have bhakti towards MGR and Amma Jayalalita. All that also you have in the south, of a level you don't find anywhere, you know. I remember when MGR died, several people committed suicide, you know. So this kind of extreme bhakti you find in the south. Be that as it may, Radha comes later. But there's a beautiful scene in the Bhagavatam when Krishna sends Uddhava, you know, because Krishna has left, you know, he has left Vrindavan and Mathura and all of those places of his childhood frolics forever. And then he feels maybe the gopis are missing me. And he sends Uddhava to teach them about Advaita. And the gopis say to Uddhava, they say, you're telling us about, you know, separation from Krishna, but we are never separated from Krishna because Krishna lives in our hearts. We have not experienced moments separation from Krishna because our union is not at the level that you're seeing, the level of the body. And you've come to teach us that I am not the body. We know that already. So Uddhava has to learn from the gopis what true bhakti, what true devotion is. And that's why when Chaitanya spread a flood of bhakti throughout Bharatvarsha, even in adverse circumstances, a flood of bhakti swept through our land. And what they did is they changed the structure of the rasas that Bharata in the Natyashastra had given. He also said that Sringara was the king of the rasas. And you had Vipralamba, that is Labdha, Sringara, and separation when you long for the beloved. And then Sambhoga, that is in union. But the great bhaktas, they said, no, it is not Sringara. Sringara is a subset of bhakti. Bhakti is the supreme rasa, you see. And that dasatva is the supreme madhurya because you consider yourself as the Lord's servant. And in the Pushti Marg, you know, there are among the Vaishnava Sampradayas, there is the Brahma Sampradaya and the Shri Sampradaya of the Ramanuja and so on. And there is this other Sampradaya called Kumara Sampradaya or Skanda Sampradaya. But in one of the Sampradayas, basically it's called Pushti Marg of Vallabha. You have to imagine that you are the gopi yourself and that you are trying to connect with Krishna. So when it is said, when Meera went to Vrindavan, you know, she was a princess and she wanted to meet the great Vaishnava guru, Haridasa. And Haridasa said, no, I don't see any women. I'm not allowed to see women. And then Meera sent him a message. She said, but I thought in Vrindavan, there was only one male. There was only one Purush, who was Krishna. And therefore, you're as much a female as I am, vis-a-vis Krishna. And we can only be like Sakhis. We are all gopis. And so Haridas sees Meera because she has transcended her sense of her physicality totally. Because she only sees Krishna, you see. And she says, Sham Mane Chakar Rakhoji. That Chakri, what we normally consider Chakri or like a service would be a great imposition. So we are always told, you know, like, you know, when I was growing up, the feminist wave hit all over the world. And the idea was if you asked your wife for a cup of tea, she said, go get it yourself, serve yourself, you know, which was wonderful because males should also serve husbands should serve their wives because Krishna presses Radha's feet. He applies alta to her feet. You know, he serves her a lot. So there's no shame in serving your wives. But you see, chakri or service becomes enjoyable because of love. That's my point. If you see that as an imposition, it's nothing but domestic drudgery. Okay, but if you consider whoever is the homemaker, it can be a male also, as the domestic god or the domestic goddess, then service can also exalt you, is all we are saying. At least the tradition says so. So now, what Swamiji is saying is that the best way to connect with the divine is through love. And you can do it in any form, as a child, as a spouse, as a friend, as a playmate, as a father or mother, you know. And that is how we can connect to the divine, okay? And then he says that in the second lecture, he says that the journey of the sadhana in our tradition is not from falsehood to truth. He says it's from truth to truth, you know, from lower truth to higher truth. And he says truth is within us. We have it as our birthright, and we only have to manifest it and make it tangible. So once again, that is practical Vedanta, to make it tangible, to move from a lower truth to a higher truth. That is practical Vedanta. And the last talk which he gave on 17th, he says, so is infinite power in the soul of man, whether he knows it or not. Its manifestation is only a question of being conscious of it. Slowly this infinite giant is, as it were, waking up, becoming conscious of his power and arousing himself, and with his growing consciousness, more and more of his bonds are breaking, chains are bursting asunder, and the day is sure to come when, with the full consciousness of his infinite power and wisdom, the giant will rise to his feet and stand erect. Let us all help to hasten that glorious consummation. So again, of course, he's quoting the Chandogya, telling you stories from it. So he delivers this on the 17th of November. So now let me try to wind up. Let me give you, as I said, some examples of impractical Vedanta, right? I already said impractical Vedanta, one meaning of it is you only have theoretical knowledge. And actually, theoretical knowledge is also important. It's essential, because unless you have a roadmap, like you have GPS, you know, you're going to a certain place, you don't know where it is, you put the GPS, you see the map, and it shows you the pathway. But if you just stand staring at the map and not start your journey, in fact, even Google Maps will tell you to press the start button, and then it says, take the next left, and 500 yards, make a left, etc. Now, if you don't follow any of the directions and sit at home, and in your imagination, you visit all those places, wonderful, but you're not going to reach your destination. So that is one example of impractical Vedanta. And to some extent, you have to start with theoretical knowledge, but without practice, it's useless. But here's another example of impractical Vedanta, okay? And I'll give you two versions of it. One from Sri Ramakrishna and one from Sadhguru, Jaggi Vasudev, okay? So I'll give you the Ramakrishna example, a little more benign. So Ramakrishna talks about this neophyte, a new student who has met his guru. And the guru says, you know, you're Brahman, I am Brahman. This table is Brahman, you know, this book is Brahman. And everything that you see is Brahman. Ishavasyam idam sarvam, yat kincha jagatyam jagat, right? The whole world is pervaded by divinity. So the student feels his consciousness is awakened, and he's strolling through the marketplace, and suddenly he hears a shout, and there is a commotion, and people are running helter-skelter. And then he asks somebody, what's happening? He's saying the elephant has gone mad. So get out of the way. And everybody's run away. But our friend says, no, it doesn't matter. Elephant is God. I am God. Everybody is God. Right? So why should I move out? Everything is Brahman. And on top of the elephant is the Mahavat, the man who's, you know, trying to control the elephant. And he says, sir, you know, oh, young student, get out of the way. The elephant is not in my control. And this man stands there and says, oh, foolish man, you don't know Vedanta. Vedanta says, you are Brahman, I am Brahman, and the elephant, before he can complete his sentence, the elephant swings his trunk and our poor student is flung aside and falls down and breaks his hand. So after several weeks, the guru is saying, where is so-and-so? You know, he's not shown up for classes. He says, sir, he broke his hand. They said, what happened? Then just then, after several weeks, he comes in, you know, limping, hand in a sling. And so he says, the guru asks, like, what happened to you, my friend? What? So he says, it's all because of Vedanta. Because you told me, you know, that I am Brahman. You know, everything is Brahman. And so when the mad elephant came, I said, everything is Brahman. Why should I get out of the way? So the guru said, you fool, if all is Brahman, the Mahavat was also Brahman who's telling you to get out of the way. Why didn't you listen to the Brahman who was the elephant driver? Why are you not listening to him? So similarly, there's a story about Mullah Nasruddin who says he only believed in Allah, okay? And the flood waters were rising. So in the morning, the floods were rising and his neighbors started evacuating. And they said, Mullahji, please leave. The river is rising. He says, no, I only believe in Allah. When Allah saves me, only then I'll go. By the afternoon, the waters had risen up. He went on to his rooftop. And then a few young men in the locality were wandering around, you know, and with boats. They said, Mullahji, with folded hands, we request you. Now the waters are rising. The boats are also gone. Let's go now. He says, no, I'm waiting for Allah. Allah will send, his messengers and they will save me. And then finally, there was a guy who was sleeping. So he had a puncture shop, you know. And, you know, in puncture shops, they always have these tubes. So he woke up, he almost was choking to death because he was drowning, but he got out of his drunken stupor and he saw Mullah standing with the water right up to his nose. He said, Mullahji, here's an extra tube, okay, tire tube. You hold on to this and I will take you to safety. And then Mullahji said, no, I only have faith in God. I don't believe in anybody else. And so the water came and the poor man died. And then he went to heaven, obviously, because he was a very pious man. And so he was very angry with Allah. So Allah said, what's the matter, my son? He says, I believed only in you. I was such a pious Muslim. 5 times a day I used to pray. I followed all the rules. And I gave zakat. I went to Mecca. I did all the things. And you didn't send me. I thought you'd send me an angel. So he said, you fool, who do you think was that? I sent you so many angels. You know, I only sent you. And finally, the tire tube guy, I sent him also. And you didn't listen to him. So this is impractical Vedanta, you see. And I'll give you the last story from Sadhguru. Wonderful story. So Sadhguru has this character called Shankaran Pillai, okay? So this Shankaran Pillai gets into all kinds of problems, okay? And as usual, you know, the same Shankaran Pillai one day, you know, went and heard the sermon of a great Advaitic guru who also said everything is Brahman. You know, who is the doer of the deed? You know, the doer is also Brahman. The deed is also Brahman. You know, and the fruit is also Brahman. The eater is also Brahman, right? And the one who plucks is also Brahman. So he had all these thoughts in his mind and his wife was trying to wake him up one day. She said, come on, wake up, go to the office. He said, no, what office? Everything is Brahman, right? So he slept in late. Then his wife said, look, I have to go to work. No breakfast for you, okay? Because time is up. I can't wait to feed you. So Shankaran Pillai wanders into his favorite restaurant and he looks at the menu and it's quite late in the day. So he says, give me one of everything. Oh, Brahman, he says, he addresses the waiter. He says, oh, Prabhuji, because you're God only, please bring me one of everything. So the waiter brings everything, and then he eats nicely, and then the waiter brings him the bill. And he says, oh, Prabhuji, what is the bill? Annam is Brahman, you are Brahman, the cook is Brahman, the food is Brahman, I'm also Brahman. So he gets up and he goes to the counter. And in the counter, the owner is there. There's a commotion because of Shankaran Pillai. And the owner says, what happened? Because he's a regular customer. She says, Mr. Pillai is not paying his bill. So the cook has also come out. Says the cook is Brahman, the waiter is Brahman, you know. And while the owner is looking the other way, he notices on the desktop, you know, a lot of loose change and some coins and some money. He says, whose money is it? It's all God's money, right? So I am Brahman, the food is Brahman, the waiter is Brahman, the cook is Brahman, the owner is Brahman, the money is Brahman, the bill is Brahman. And so he takes a fistful of coins and some notes and he leaves the restaurant. And the owner comes running. He says, Mr. Pillai, what are you doing? You didn't pay the bill and now you're even taking the money from the counter? He says, what are you saying? This is Brahman. You are Brahman. And like that, he walks out. And when he walks out, the owner says, you've had it now, Mr. Pillai. I have to report you to the police. He reports him to the police, and Mr. Shankaran Pillai is taken to the police station and immediately presented before the magistrate. He says, why did you do this? He starts laughing to the magistrate. He says, Mr. Magistrate, what are you telling me? All this is rubbish. You are Brahman. I am Brahman. Food is Brahman. The policeman is Brahman. You know, the money is Brahman. So the magistrate says, I will now teach you practical Vedanta, Mr. Shankaran Pillai. 20 lashes for Mr. Pillai, he says. So the man comes out and he starts lashing him. So after the fourth lash, all his impractical Vedanta leaves him. And he says, help, help. He says, no, the lash is Brahman. The pain is Brahman. The welt is Brahman. The magistrate is Brahman, the policeman is Brahman, the monitor is Brahman. So after 15 lashes, he starts calling out for his wife. The magistrate calls his wife, who bails him out, takes him home. And that is the end of Mr. Pillai's impractical Vedanta. So now we come to an end. I want to tell you the story from Markandeya Purana. I don't know if you can play that lullaby I've sent to Vrindaji. I've sent the link. You can play it in a moment and we'll end on that. But it's a wonderful story of Madalasa, okay, who was a very great queen in ancient India. And I heard her story for the first time from, I think, Gurumai Amrita, you know, this. She's a very famous, spiritual teacher. And she told the story. And in her story, in Guruma's story, Anandamurti Guruma, you can look her up. In Guruma's story, when I heard it, she has seven children, seven sons, Madalasa. In some other version, she has four sons, right? But her wife, she was the wife of a very great king. And the story is that names of these children, you know, of his sons. And Madalasa used to laugh. And finally, the king was very upset and says, for the fourth son, select the name yourself. And she selects the name Alarka, the mad one, and laughs again. And which means mad dog, apparently. And so here's the story of Madalasa, where she says, Shuddhosi, Buddhosi, and so on. Niranjanosi. This is the beautiful lullaby she sings to her children. So when Guruma narrated it, she told us how the mother, the father, that is the king, wanted, an heir and a successor who ruled the kingdom. But Guruma turned all her sons into rishis and renouncers, you know, and finally left one. She tells the story in her own inimitable way, left one to rule the kingdom. Anyhow, the story is complicated and it's in the Markandeya Purana. I was just reading it because Bibek Deb Roy, Dr. Bibek Deb Roy has translated it. Penguin has published it. You can look at it. But in India, we believe that the mothers are far more important than fathers because the mothers awaken the child's spiritual instincts. So they say, if you read, you know, there's a very wonderful little book from Pondicherry. You know, the mother has made that book. The mother, that is Meera Alfasa, who was Sri Aurobindo's successor and spiritual partner. And she calls it prenatal education. That is the education, the spiritual education of the baby starts before birth, prenatal. And she gives the example of Shivaji's mother, Jijabai. You know, and many other examples are given. But even from Europe. And I remember I had met Zakir Hussain, the great tabla maestro. Okay. And I met Allah Rakha also, his father, by the way, once. And so he told me, he said that Zakir Hussain learned the tabla before he was born because they used to do riyaz. The father used to play and this baby, the fetus before being born, he learned a lot, you know, and when he was born, he already knew, you know, so he was born a genius. So mothers are the ones, you know, who give the, actually impart the spiritual wisdom. And this was the ancient practice in India, that the mothers awakened the spiritual knowledge latent inside, you know, the baby. So that is what we believe in India. And, you know, I heard a talk by Sadhguru and recently we met him. And I want to then give you the link later of this conversation we had with him. You can also watch it as a part of our Indian Institute of Advanced Study Activities. We recorded a wonderful conversation with Sadhguru called Pongal Dialogue for a Conscious Planet. Okay? Pongal Dialogue for a Conscious Planet. But the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, he has said that our job is not to leave our homes and go and live in an ashram, but to turn our homes into an ashram. Right? And only mothers can do that. They can create the right atmosphere and vibration for a spiritual awakening. And I think somebody said in the beginning, in the slideshow, and this is Swamiji's words, that now is the time for mass spiritual awakening. It's not for the elect or the select, you know, or for the elite, but for everyone. Because I think we are on the cusp, you know, of a global spiritual revolution. And I think India has to play a very important role. And all the mothers of the land and the sisters and the daughters, they have to awaken this latent spirituality, you know, and they can do it because through their affection and love and tenderness, and even in the food, the intention that you put inside the food, you know, that awakens the latent spiritual samskaras, and the vasanas will reduce, you know. So I think that with these words, we can conclude and listen to Madalasa's lullaby. So when she was putting the crying child to sleep, she was awakening, you know, she was giving the child Brahma Vidya. And this is our great tradition of Bharat, you know, and let us end with that. If you can play that, I would be very grateful.
Yes, sir, I will play it, but I don't have the link that you have sent.
But I sent you the link. Just scroll up in the chat and click on the link. I've said, Vrindaji, please play the song clip when I request it, if you don't mind. Go to the chat.
Yes, I'll just see.
Okay.
Yes, I
Yes.
An inspiring, resourceful, vibrant, thoughtful execution of views connected to the theoretical, practical, and impractical knowledge of Vedanta. Through simple facts, simple stories, incidents taken from great spiritual leaders and epics, etc. Dear Dr. Magarand, you know, I completely understood that to lead a spiritual life, you need not have to seek salvation in a faraway place like a mountain cave. But you can create your own spiritual zone and experience it wherever you are. Thank you so much. Dear friends, let me now create a space for the attendees to create their voice and space for interaction to enhance our understanding and learning experiences. The floor is open for discussion. Those who want to share your views, your queries, can be done now. Over to our members.
Well, I have about 5 or 7 minutes, so maybe I can just take 3 or 4 questions together and answer them.
I would like to, I really can't believe we were just talking about this particular lullaby a couple of days back when we were thinking about, really awesome to hear this from you, sir. I really literally got goosebumps, because just 2 days back, we were talking about how deluded we are, with the current situation, the COVID and the lockdown, and we just seem to be running around. And then we were talking about this particular lullaby, and we had actually done this, and to hear this coming from you, such a learned person, is an honor. I mean, I was not even supposed to, this is just so coincidental that, absolutely thrilled to be here. And I find your talk about this particular in this session actually made a lot of sense, because we deal with students. And the spirituality, when we look at it, the students immediately start taking a backseat because there's so much theory involved. But when speakers like you, learned people like you, are able to bring it down to their level and relate, you made it seem so relatable that, the whole concept of spirituality, as you say, we are right now on a cusp of, a huge revolution. And I think the youngsters, taking it to the youngsters is the way to go. And absolutely thrilled to be here, sir. Absolutely thrilled to be here. I just had one question. How can we make this concept of spirituality more relatable to the youngsters? Because the theory is very daunting. I mean, we talk about Puranas, the basis is spirituality transcends religion also, especially the Bhakti movement. So how do we take this to the youngsters?
Yes, absolutely. Very good question. Can we just take 2-3 more and then I can try to address them together? And I'm so glad that this Madalasa Lullaby...
I have a question, sir. I'm Raji Rajesh. So you were initially talking, when you started about practical Vedanta, you said there is no sin in Vedanta and there is only error. So how do we relate that to the concept of right and wrong and the ever-changing paradigm of right and wrong that we are so conditioned to? So if there's nothing, there is a sin, then how do we distinguish between right and wrong in guiding our own behavior, if not anyone else's?
Totally, totally. Very good question. Excellent. Maybe one more, because these are very deep questions. So we'll have...
So, you can make it as brief as you.
Okay. We'll take one more and then I'll try and address all three of them together.
Bhuma, do you have a question?
Please unmute Bhuma before you talk. Bhuma, please unmute.
You have your hand raised. Do you
sorry,
have a question?
Sorry. I want to share this with all of you. I like this talk very much, sir. And the lullaby was really great. And the Sadhguru's Shankaran Pillai story on impractical Vedanta, really, I understood one thing from here. Ultimately, by just holding the holy feet of Brahma, we should continue to do our duties in this world. That is what I understood from this talk. And as you say, generally the mothers awaken the child's spirituality. I try to tell lots of, I make my grandchild, granddaughter learn a lot, who is in California, learn lots of slogans and stories and etc. I don't know whether that is enough. And really whether she believes in God, I don't know. Whenever she has some trouble, she calls me and says, Amama, pray for me. So I just want you to tell whether we can do something more for the, maybe for youngsters or our own grandchildren. That's all I want to ask, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Bhumaji and Rajiji. And I didn't get your name, Jayashriji. Fantastic. I think in a very interesting way, you've answered each other's questions. For example, Rajiji's question about what is right and wrong has been answered by the Shankaran Pillai story. Obviously, saying everything is Brahman and taking somebody's money, not paying your bill, will not work. And I think if you ask what is... the difference between what Vivekananda says and what the story illustrates, it's not different, because it's not sin, but it's error. You know, to think that everything is Brahman and therefore I can steal somebody's money is an error. And of course, you might say it's a sin to an extent, because it doesn't matter. The point is that sin is also an error. See, we torture others, or we try to take away other people's things. We trouble others. We don't practice ahimsa. We don't practice a truth because we feel somehow we'll benefit. There's some interest in it of ours. And that is an error. So only when you're awakened to think that if I'm hurting someone, I'm hurting myself, because that person is no different from me. You know, we are all selves. There's no self in other, etc., etc. So for that metaphysical insight to dawn may take a long time. But if mother says, don't do this, the child will simply understand. And if the child is very stupid, then the mother will say, why? Okay, do it and see, and give him one tight slap, you know. So all of that is valid, is what I'm saying. That is practical Vedanta. The mother will see how intelligent the child is. The child is super intelligent. Then they'll say, look, there's, you know, the fact is that just as, you know, you're a sentient being, that dog is also a sentient being. You know, if you're torturing the dog, then the dog is getting hurt, just as you're getting hurt. But if the child doesn't have that capacity, the mother can simply say, I told you so. And most children will listen. But the really, whatever, truant child, the child who's a mischief maker, should. Mother will say, okay, you don't listen. Okay, now see what happens to you like that. So I think that's the answer to the question. But at a deeper level, even in Christian theology, who made Satan? So Satan is the source of all evil. Satan is actually Lucifer. He's a fallen angel. God has made Satan also. So when what Swamiji teaches Nivedita is that even evil is only God. God is not only benevolence. So only the Hindus can worship God as both Saumya and Ugra, as Kali with the garland of heads and as Shri Lakshmi. No? Now, your Jayashriji, question also has been wonderfully answered by Bhumaji. You don't have to, for children, young people, you don't have to give them any tattva jnana or brahma jnana, nothing. Just stories is enough. All children just love stories. In fact, I find adults also love stories. So the Shankaran Pillai stories are very, very popular because adults also love stories. So I think storytelling is an age-old and tried and tested method of awakening the spirituality inherent in children. There's no point giving them moral lessons, because I'll tell you why. As you know, children, if you're a teacher, you'll know. See, you can't lie to your students, and parents can't lie to their children, because children are not seeing what, I mean, they see you in action. They don't listen to your words alone. So they'll see a contradiction between what you're preaching. For example, you'll say, don't tell lies. And then they'll hear you tell lies to somebody, you know. And they'll say, but mama, you said don't tell lies. Now you're telling lies to so-and-so. You're saying that, I've got a headache. I can't come to your party. But you have no headache. You're fine. Then the mother says, you don't understand. In society, we have to do all this. So children will not be convinced. They learn from example, not from precept. I mean, they don't learn from precept, they learn from practice, okay? So if you cannot embody, if you cannot practice what you preach, there's no point preaching at all. So I think the whole point about practical Vedanta is you practice it first. Those who want to understand will pick it up. Those who don't want to understand it will not pick it up. And I believe that if you tell the children properly, then you can say, for example, yes, I lied, I agree, because blah, blah, blah. The child will understand that my mom is not a habitual liar, or my teacher is not a habitual liar, but for certain, because children are very intelligent. It's not that you can fool them. So this is the whole point. We treat children badly, within quotes badly, because we think they don't understand. Actually, they understand a lot. And we have to give the respect that is due to another Atman. It's not just a child in a little body, it's an Atman. So you can't be bluffing and doing one thing. So similarly with teachers, you know, no student will respect you, because I've done nothing but basically read and write and study and teach all my life. And I know that no student will respect you if you do not practice what you're preaching. You know, and now the final question to Bhumaji. I think you're doing wonderfully well. And I think that when your grandchildren from abroad are saying, pray for you, pray for us, they have so much faith. They have more faith in the grandmother than in God, because they can directly pray to God, but they don't know who God is, but they know who their grandmother Amma is. So when they say, Amma, pray for us, they mean they feel in their heart that your prayer is going to count. Your prayer is going to make a difference. And I think that if that faith they can have in you, that means you're a very great Amma. That's all I can say. And I'm sure that whatever you're doing will awaken in them that feeling. And you should say, of course, I'll pray for you. But you should also pray. You also pray. Something you can do. You can improvise. And I think, in the moment, you know, when we surrender to a higher intelligence, we get guided. But when our own vrittis, and especially our, a lot of klishta, because it's caused our kleshas. But, we ourselves muddy up everything, frankly. And so if you are open to that higher, I would say, energy and light and, like the aura, your website tells it all, if you're open to that aura of divinity and nobility and magnificence, I'm sure that the others who come in your aura will also be transformed, and you don't have to say much. That's what I have found. So with those words, I take leave of you. It was wonderful to meet all of you. And I wish you, great success in Trichy, in the work you're doing. And I hope more people join your club. It's hardly a normal kind of club. And I think that, I think many will be benefited. That's what I feel. Because all of you are so gifted yourself. And so learned and very successful in your own fields. And as the Mahabharata says, you see, actually only 7% of the 100% really can make a difference, because the remaining, why do I say 7? Because 90% will follow 10%. And of the 10%, 3% will only go for bhog vilas, whatever happens. Even if, when the bombs were going off, I was there and there were still parties happening, people were sending invites. So these people you cannot change, 3% of the people in the world, they can't change, you can't change them, you should let them go. But if you can affect that 7%, then you get 97%. So I think we have to target that 7%, and aura will make a difference by targeting that 7% of the ladies of Trichy, then you'll get 97%. And 3%, you can let them do what they like. Okay? Thank you so much. Thank you. I have to leave. I'm sorry. I have a lot of other pending things, and it's a working day for us. So you have to excuse me.
Thank you,
sir. Dear Dr. Bakhrand, we are privileged to have you as a guest today, sir. And we are fully confident that your knowledge, experience, and expertise will provide important insights in strengthening us. Thank you so much, sir, from the bottom of the heart.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all. Thank you. I take leave of you now. Thank you. Bye.
Dear Auro ladies, that wraps our morning. May I thank you all very much for your active participation and hope you all enjoyed this event. It has been my pleasure to host this day and wish you all a very pleasant day. Spirituality is not glorification of God, but it is about enhancement of you. Thank you all.
Wonderful, Lata.
Thank you so much.